morning. My name is Linda Randolph. I'm a member of the board of Tennessee Valley Unitarian Universalist Church. And I welcome you on behalf of the board and program council. You're welcome here, whoever you are, wherever you're from, wherever you are on your journey. If you'd like more information about this church, TVUUC, you can fill out the visitor information card on the back of the seat in front of you. Per COVID, Knox County's risk remains low. So at this level, we still have we still are encouraging masks and vaccinations, but they're not required. If you want to be in a masked area, go to the Lizzie Crozier French Room, and that's a designated viewing space for those who prefer that everyone else be masked along with themselves. I have two announcements. One, what is Questions, Q-U-U-E-S-T-I-O-N-S? Questions is a new meeting we have for visitors or those who want to know more about TVUUC, Unitarian Universalism, and the path to membership. It's open to current members who may want to deepen their connection to TVUUC and UUism as well. Mark Mahundro leads that session, and we have one today in the Lizzie Crozier French Room at 12:30. If you or your family are interested in our youth religious education program, the education table is set up in the lobby, and that's staffed by Miriam Davis today. She's our assistant director of religious education. We have one more announcement from Betty and Casey.
I really want you guys to know I want you to have a good morning. It's super important to me. I'm Betty Kidd, and this is Casey Clark, and together we're Let's Connect. Next Sunday is the first Sunday of the month, so of course we will be hosting our much anticipated and very enjoyable first Sunday lunch. The board will be sponsoring the next first Sunday lunch, and there will be a sign up posted on Facebook and in the newsletter this week, so please sign up. We'll be having a taco bar themed fiesta. So we look forward to doing that with everyone. And then today is your last chance to vote for Volunteer of the Month. The ballot box is in the fellowship hall on the table to the left of the room as you're entering the fellowship hall, and we really want the congregation to participate in this. So please vote. Thank you.
Yes. Now, if you'll please silence your electronic devices as we move forward together in worship.
In Flanders Fields is a poem that is in the voice of fallen soldiers who have recently been buried near the battlefield. And as the ground has been churned up by digging and bombs and battle, the poppies that were in the ground have naturally emerged and blossomed between their graves. And so we're singing this song in honor of Memorial Day.
Thank you. Good morning. My name is Mark Mohundro. I'm one of the lay leaders here at church. And our guest speaker this morning is the Reverend Jake Morrill. Jake Morrill grew up at TVUUC and for 19 years served as lead minister of our neighboring congregation in Oak Ridge. He is a former trustee on the board of the Unitarian Universalist Association, and currently Jake is a leadership coach with businesses seeking cultures of greater emotional maturity. He and his wife Molly are proud parents of two teenagers.
It's not November, but we're here for Thanksgiving. It's not dinner time, but we're here for a feast. We gather this morning as those who've been disappointed, heartbroken, ticked off, full of grief, but we're here anyway as those stubborn in faithfulness and determined in joy. So let us bind ourselves one to the other under the holy canopy of this hour, and having brought the true gifts of our hearts, prepare to receive each of us the gifts of new life.
Come, let us worship together.
From you I
remain standing in body and spirit, and if you turn in your bulletin to the third page, I believe it is, that's the hymn we're going to be singing. It is We Are Children of Earth by Sharon Scholl.
My name is Jake, and I grew up in this church. Actually, I grew up in this community when the building was down the street. And more than anything else, what I'd love is for you guys to keep playing while I'm talking. and maybe not even pay attention to me unless you want to. Once upon a time, there was a little girl named Deborah Gordon who loved to notice things in the world, critters, insects, bugs, how the weather changed. And she grew up and she became a professor at Stanford University, and she still liked to look at critters and crawly things and insects and how life moved. And so for over 25 years, maybe even longer now, every spring she would go to a plot of land in southwestern Arizona, and she'd get down on her knees with her students, because there were people who wanted to learn how to notice things too. And they'd watch these red harvester ants moving around in colonies. And they began to watch these colonies of ants very closely. A colony of ants doesn't have a boss. There's no grown-up ants telling you what to do. There's no teacher ants. There's a queen ant, but she doesn't even tell people or ants what to do. She just gives birth and sort of is happy that the colony is figuring out what to do. Different ants have different jobs. This is what Deborah Gordon found out by watching them, noticing. Some of them patrol in the morning to see where the food is. Others of them go out and get the food, foragers. Some of them stay back and are nest maintenance ants. And some of them are garbage ants, taking out the garbage, the midden ants. And one of the things that I love is that she figured out that over time, even though there aren't any storyteller ants, or teacher ants, or expert ants, or boss ants, that as a colony grows, it begins to learn. As this community of ants moves together, for instance, they might learn that there is a branch in the way over here, so you got to go around that way if you're going to get to the food. And even though those ants who figured that out in year 3 might have long since died, in year 12, the community of ants still remembers that lesson. There's that branch there. You got to go around. In other words, they pass on what they know from generation to generation. Nobody's writing it down. Nobody's telling stories. The community teaches the ones rising up. Well, Deborah Gordon has done different kinds of experiments on this, and she's figured out that if you block one pathway to food, where the ants have figured out to go get food, they just figure out another path. They figure out a plan B. They don't check a book. They don't have a policy manual. They just kind of work it out with each other and work out a plan B. And why I thought it was so cool that you guys kept on playing here is that I was watching how creative and how awesome some of these towers and walls and bridges you were building were, and how you were working with each other. And I was thinking, these guys don't need anybody telling them how to do stuff. They don't need anybody saying, put this block there, put this block there. You guys know already exactly what you want to do, and you're working it out with each other. Like this tower you're building right there, or whatever this game you're trying to start there is. I don't know. You're making the middle out of these. Yeah, so if she makes a hammer, she can bash the middle out?
Yep.
Yeah, okay. I never would have thought of that. I'm so glad you're not listening for what my idea is, because yours is better. All I'm saying is that Deborah Gordon has learned over her life that there's a lot you can learn when you watch how groups of ants figure out problems together. And I think there's a lot to learn when everybody watches how kids figure things out together. That's the story for today. Thanks for being here.
And now, as our learners and leaders go to their spaces, we will play them out.
Thank you.
This reading is an excerpt from Adrienne Marie Brown's Emergent Strategy. Do you already know that your existence, who and how you are, is in and of itself a contribution to the people and place around you? Not after or because of you do some particular thing, but simply the miracle of life. And that the people around you and the places have contributions as well. Do you understand that your quality of life and survival are tied to how authentic and generous the connections are between you and the people and place you live with and in? Are you actively practicing generosity and vulnerability in order to make the connections between you and others clear, open, available, durable? Generosity here means giving of what you have without strings or expectations attached. Vulnerability means showing your needs.
Good morning. It's good to be here with you all this morning. And if I could just invite everybody to turn to the camera with the red light on up there, it just changed on me, and just wave and say good morning to everybody who is also joining us online this morning here. We are one community here in this space, but also online. Thank you to the camera crews for being flexible. Appreciate that. I am Reverend John Coffey, a member of the spiritual care team, and on Sunday mornings, we bring the joys and concerns of our community in acknowledgement of our shared lives together. If you have a joy or concern to share, or you would just like to talk to somebody on the spiritual care team, you can reach out to the pastoral care line and connect with one of us. That number is 865-297-3155, and the number is also printed in your order of service and our weekly newsletter. This morning, I have a joy of my own to share by way of leading into other joys and concerns that I'm going to share this morning, and that is that last week at Meadville Lombard Theological School, we celebrated our 178th graduation ceremony, where we graduated 11 new students from Meadville Lombard Theological School. So that was very exciting, yes. Which means that I was busy doing that instead of watching what joys and concerns were mentioned last Sunday. So if you hear some repeats this morning, that's why. This morning, our thoughts and prayers are with Cynthia Crosby Myers, who reports that she is feeling better as of Thursday, but she has had COVID for 3 weeks now and says she's really tired of it. She's impatient to get back to church, to her water aerobics class, and her band practice. Meanwhile, she's pulling a few weeds each day, getting some fresh air, and watching her faithful companion, Sam the German Shepherd, chase squirrels in her backyard. Sarah Miller's mother, Vivian, who several of us met last week when Autumn graduated, has been visiting from the UK. Unfortunately, Vivian had a fall earlier this week and is recovering at Sarah's house, where they're enjoying fostering a few kittens as part of the healing process. And I got a report from Sue Kersey this morning who says that Vivian is up and about and actually may be here this morning. Nope. Maybe out doing something else exciting this morning to celebrate. We also celebrate with MJ Aiken, who received good news at a checkup for multiple sclerosis. It was really good news, and we celebrate with MJ. And we celebrate, oh, hi. We're celebrating with you this morning, and glad to see you. We celebrate with Jerry Bone's daughter, Tammy L. Bone, who just graduated with an MBA with honors from Morse College in the Honor Society Pi Alpha Alpha. So, let's give a round of applause. With these joys and concerns mentioned here, and those joys and concerns in our hearts but left unspoken, I invite you to join me in our congregational response. I am sending you light. The words are printed in your order of service. Y'all rehearse that this morning? Thank y'all, that sounded great. This morning's spoken prayer is adapted from a passage in Tress of the Emerald Sea by Brandon Sanderson. And before I begin, I want to invite you to think of a time in your life when you just got something. You just understood something. Maybe it was a skill you were trying to learn. Maybe it was something that just completely surprised you at how good you were at it. But think about that moment and think about the joy that you felt in that moment. Even if you're at a point in your life right now where maybe you don't feel like celebrating, recall that time as we read these words. One of the great tragedies in life is knowing how many people in the world are made to soar, to paint, to sing, to steer, except they never get a chance to find out. Whenever one does discover such a moment, it is a moment of joy, and beauty enters the world. Human beings, we can't create energy. We can only harness it. We can't create matter. We can only shape it. We can't even create life. We can only nurture it. But we can create light. And this is one of the ways. The feeling of joy in discovering a purpose. This morning, whether we find ourselves in that space of discovery or just need the spark of light from joy remembered, let us take a few moments of silence to call to mind that moment of joy or that spark of light. Returning from our silence, friends, human beings, we can create light. And this is one of the ways, the effervescence of purpose discovered. May we hold that this morning.
Fourscore and 7 years ago, our fathers brought forth on this continent a new nation, conceived in liberty and dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal. Now we are engaged in a great civil war, testing whether that nation, or any nation so conceived and so dedicated, can long endure. We are met on a great battlefield of that war. We have come to dedicate a portion of that field as a final resting place for those who gave their lives that this nation might live. It is altogether fitting and proper that we should do this. But in a larger sense, we cannot dedicate, we cannot consecrate, we cannot hallow this ground. The brave men, living and dead, who struggled here, have consecrated it far above our poor power to add or detract. The world will little note, nor long remember, what we say here, but it can never forget what they did here. It is for us, the living, rather to be dedicated here to the unfinished work which they who fought here have thus so far nobly advanced. It is rather for us to be here dedicated to the great task remaining before us, that from these honored dead, we take increased devotion to that cause for which they gave the last full measure of devotion. That we here highly resolve that these dead shall not have died in vain, that in this nation, under God, shall have a new birth of freedom, and that government of the people, by the people, for the people, shall not perish from this earth.
I feel very unworthy breaking that silence after that. So let me just say briefly, today's offering is a designated offering for Volunteer Ministry Center. You can look in the bulletin to see how to give, offering baskets, kiosk, in the lobby, online. There is a give button. Thank you for being here.
Thank you.
Please rise in body and spirit as we sing our next hymn, hymn number 318 in your gray hymnal, We Would Be One, hymn number 318.
Well, greetings from the far corners of Anderson County. When I preach here and there, usually the first line in my introduction is that Jake Morrill is a product of the religious education program at Tennessee Valley UU Church. So for better or worse, well, it doesn't always go well, so you know, you take the bad with the good there, but I'm just letting you know your name's out there. In 1954, English novelist William Golding published the classic young adult novel, The Lord of the Flies. It's the story of a group of English school children who survive a plane crash in the Pacific, only to end up stranded on an island, far from adult authority and established civilization. They initially rally around the leadership of a boy named Ralph, who sets clear priorities and a semblance of order before everything devolves into superstition and the brutal dynamics that produce destruction. These days, the phrase the Lord of the Flies has come to mean a situation in which anarchy has produced the worst of humankind, bullying, chaos, the tragic end of a group. The implication is that the sensible approach to things in a group is to establish the customs of formal governance, rules, roles, policies. Without the structure of governance and clearly delineated policies, people in a group just can't be trusted. Underneath this view is an assumption of human nature as essentially deficient, in need of control to keep us all safe. A famous proponent of this view is the 17th century philosopher Thomas Hobbes, who said that outside of orderly society, life would be solitary, poor, nasty, brutish, and short. Bet he was fun at lunch. Therefore, said Hobbes, to guard against our craven nature, what humans needed was some powerful person or parliament. In other words, as illustrated in The Lord of the Flies, groups of people on their own just can't be trusted. In the field of economics, the classic model of this line of thinking is called the tragedy of the commons. Here's the tragedy of the commons. Imagine that there is a village of 10 houses all built on the edge of a meadow that they hold in common. Each household can let their cows graze on the grass. As long as each household does it sustainably, it works out. When a fence needs fixing, they'll pull together, fix the fence. Here's the problem, though. What if one household decides to exploit the situation? What if one household decides to buy 200 cows who disproportionately chew up the grass and wreck things for others? The humble village would have no way to protect against such selfishness. Sure, they might beg, plead, and cajole, but appealing to this selfish villager's sense of morality would fall flat. In this model, the meadow where the cows graze is called a common pool asset. Stick with me, because it's going to be relevant to your life. A common pool asset is something that we collectively benefit from and manage. It could be a meadow, it could be air quality, it could be the kitchen sink in a church kitchen. And the tragedy of the commons says that because of people's inevitable selfishness and eventual impulse to dominate one another, the only way to sustain order and to manage a common pool asset, whether meadow, air quality, or church kitchen sink, is to impose some form of centralized control. People who tend toward a right-wing political perspective advocate centralizing control through privatization. If somebody owns that meadow, they'll set things right. And people who tend toward a left-wing political perspective advocate centralizing control through the state. Is there trouble in the meadow? Create laws with consequences. If somebody breaks the law by grazing too many cattle, there will be fines to pay and perhaps even arrest. Both of these political prescriptions, whether left or right, rest on the assumption that people can't be trusted to govern themselves, that we devolve into a Hobbesian Lord of the Flies scenario. And so safety and order can only be sustained by centralized control, ensured by the threat of violence, police, jail, etc. There's plenty of evidence all over to support this dim view of humanity. Let's look at the state of politics today. Look at the manufactured debt ceiling crisis in Congress this weekend. It's a dog-eat-dog world. People can't be trusted. Shoot, look at the kitchen sink in this church. Some people are just going to take advantage. I didn't even ask anybody about the kitchen sink here at TVUUC. I've just been to a lot of churches. So I know there's probably some drama around your sink. The tragedy of the commons, that groups of people need to be controlled in some centralized manner, drifted forth largely unexamined, assumed to be true in the popular imagination, until 2009, when news broke that somebody named Elinor Ostrom had won the Nobel Prize in economics. And as the story goes, economists all over the world rushed to Wikipedia to find out just who this person was. Certainly, she wasn't part of the club. Elinor Ostrom grew up poor in Southern California in the years after World War II. After an unhappy early marriage, she pursued graduate education in political science at UCLA. In her early research, she studied water management in the Los Angeles water basin. A clear observation that she had was that people at City Hall, the experts and professionals tasked with managing the water supply, looked at things very differently, had a whole different vocabulary and perspective than people out in the neighborhoods who were using the water. That may seem obvious, but in the time, the idea that there was any other perspective than what was at City Hall was downright revolutionary, if not mildly offensive. Ostrom observed that what actually produced the best outcome for water management was not centralization, but when different groups at different levels of the scenario, household, neighborhood, city, region, state, when these different levels could figure out a way to coordinate from level to level. She called this concept polycentric governance. In other words, the idea not that decisions should be concentrated in one node, one location, one city hall, but instead that people of different perspectives and locations should find ways to communicate and to coordinate to arrive at the best outcome. In the early 1970s, Ostrom and her husband, Victor, worked with many graduate students. And I just want to say this, they were at Indiana University. And usually in academic settings, what they established, a well-funded place, would be called a center. She did not want to call it a center. She called it a workshop.
because she said it was a collaborative enterprise. It was not a center, but it was, anyway. This extensive observation revealed that small local groups, so she has people all over the world, like up in Canada watching small fishing villages, all throughout the African continent watching water management, Asia watching communities managing forests. So that's, she's just got people all over watching small local groups and how do they function. And what they noticed over this reams of data collection is that over time, small local groups develop jointly, ecologically and economically sustainable ways to care for and to benefit from these resources, forest, fish, well, etc. In fact, she identified 8 principles that such groups tend to develop all over the world in different contexts. And yes, these principles of high-functioning villages and local groups address the problem of what if one member is selfish and tries to take advantage. These groups have ways of dealing with problems like that. The point is, counter to the assumption of the tragedy of the commons, the answer is not to centralize power, but that small local groups the world over can work out together what's best for themselves through the dynamics of trust and cooperation, through relationship, through the emergent process of just working it out. Toward the end of Ostrom's career, evolutionary biologist David Sloan Wilson began to collaborate with her, noticing that her observation of human groups was related to findings in evolutionary biology with its shift from the focus on individuals, Richard Dawkins and the selfish gene, etc., to the survival of successful groups, group-level selection in evolution. In other words, what Ostrom's research found for groups, for people, might have deeper implications for how life functions and survives and thrives. Having said all of this, at any point, actually at any point in life, but especially in a sermon, it's helpful to ask the question, who cares? So what? So what? What does how a fishing village in Newfoundland or a forest village in Thailand have to do with what I'm up against here in my own life in East Tennessee? What does all of this pie in the sky talk of groups that work through cooperation and trust have to do with a year 2023 where no one is listening, everybody's jockeying for power, and society seems more like the Lord of the Flies than ever? Good question. In response, I've got a story. Both of my teenagers are rabid soccer players, so when we took a family trip to England last fall, at the top of their list was not visiting the Tower of London or Buckingham Palace or any of the other boring things their father wanted to do. What they wanted to do was to find a pickup game of soccer in a country where people know how to take the game seriously. They wanted to test their chops on that kind of field. So one Sunday night, we took multiple subway trains to get out to East London, the most diverse part of the city, where people from all over the world gather and live and make their lives and form community. And from the last subway stop, tube stop, we walked a mile through neighborhoods with suboptimal signage, I have to say. I was thinking maybe we should just go home, but they pressed on. We made our way through these streets, through these neighborhoods, and there it was, a soccer pitch. Already the game had begun. 20 or so men, ages 20 or 50 or so, swarming the field, first this way and that, in coordinated and elegant fashion. They were, I found out, from all over Europe and from North Africa. Within seconds, my kids were swept up in the action, fully part of the game. Up and down the field, here and there. One of my abiding interests is collective behavior. We all need something to geek out, and that's what I geek out on. How groups behave and decide things together. Next month, I'll spend a week in New Mexico at the Santa Fe Institute with people who study flock behavior and how bee colonies make decisions and so forth. So on the sidelines, as I'm watching this game of soccer, I was also watching a demonstration of collective behavior, different from the games of soccer I often watch here at home. Here at home, watching my kids play, I often observe highly regulated games governed by a referee who everyone on both sides is convinced is wrong. There is a lot of focus at these games on the referee because there is a lot of authority vested in the referee. They can make a call, good or bad, that can fundamentally alter the outcome of the game. And so there's a lot of attention and anxiety and verbiage aimed at that one single person out on the field. But that's not what's happening at that pickup game in East London. When someone called a foul, when someone fouled, someone else would shout, "Foul," and the game would stop and then resume quickly with a kick. There was one player who was playing too aggressively, an older guy, so I had some sympathy. You know, you do what you can at a certain point. And he was upset at the fouls that the group kept calling on him, so he complained, and as he did, I observed the self-governing group behaviors that Elinor Ostrom would have predicted. In other words, they didn't kick him out or shame him, nor did they ignore his behavior. His behavior didn't spoil the game. Instead, they had the wherewithal collectively to deal with this malcontent before then focusing back on the game and resuming. Among people who are serious about soccer, there is respect for what happens in the streets or in pickup games. In these unregulated spaces, players sharpen their skills and practice the interdependence of this collective behavior without needing to keep an eye on a coach or a ref. A similar case can be made for free-range children who organize their own play and activities outside the control or direction of adult authority. Some of us saw that in action this morning. These kids did not need somebody saying, "Put that block there." In fact, that would have gotten in the way. There's research, tons of research on roughhousing, that roughhousing helps kids develop such important developmental qualities like boundaries, trust, a sense of self, and coordination. I mention all of this today, this description of emergent, collective, swarming behavior, because in the Christian calendar today, it's Pentecost, 40 days after Easter. The Pentecost story early on in the book of Acts is the story of how the Christian tradition goes on after the death of Jesus. To this point, things have not always been easy for that early Christian community, but they've also been pretty simple. When in doubt, follow Jesus. Jesus was the recognized leader in whom knowledge and authority was centralized. But now, in the weeks after his death, his followers are scattered and confused, even, and they're under siege. They gather in the upper room to figure out what to do. And I imagine one of his disciples pulling out a copy of John Carver's Policy Governance, saying, "We need to elect leaders and to adopt Robert's Rules of Orders, otherwise all is lost." And of course, throughout the life of Jesus, we see the disciples jostling for position. Nevertheless, whatever assumptions they bring to the room and whatever they're talking about, all of that negotiation and worry is interrupted by a mighty wind that sweeps in and through them. Imagine if we were here this morning, half asleep, and through the windows came a force like a wind that changed your whole life. That's what happened in that room, says the story. They have delight and they speak in tongues with such abandon that others at a distance suspect they are drunk. Even though not everyone speaks the same language, they nonetheless are able to receive and understand one another. Imagine. In other words, after the death of Jesus, the answer for how they would go on and thrive was not to immediately find another powerful individual who could take the place of Christ. Instead, their task, what they found out to do, was to reimagine what the word Christ meant. Now no longer was the body of Christ an individual. The body of Christ was now the members of the community gathered and joined together, functioning in their diversity and yet with one purpose. The idea that the body of Christ is a community alive in joy and united in covenant and transformed by the living power of God is at the heart of my faith. I say this provocatively, knowing that many in this room would, to put it mildly, put it another way. I say that knowing that I seek holy community, this holy community that I'm describing, with atheists, humanists, pagans, Buddhists, eclectic, Unitarian Universalists, and others who would describe their own dream and experience and ways of knowing in different language, with different terms. And I say it knowing that in the Pentecost story, it says that the members of the community each spoke in their own authentic tongue, Each stayed rooted in their own diversity and authenticity, and yet were received and understood across that difference by one another. Dang. So I ask you, as you look at your life this morning, are you living a version of the Lord of the Flies, certain that what's needed is control and centralized authority to safeguard against the inevitable fallenness and treachery of humankind? Or do you see the world around you more like an undulating and teeming game of pickup soccer in East London, where people of different cultures, perspectives, and tongues join together on one common field to work out together how they will collectively discover and embody the most thriving vision of life? When you gather here as a congregation, are you looking for the guardrails that will govern and safeguard how you are together? Or are you giving yourself over? Are you surrendering yourself to the living power of love, which invites you to outrageous co-creation and joy? This isn't a question only for one congregation, but for the broader circumference of our common life. We gather this morning in the wreckage of democracy in an angry nation consumed with mistrust and attempts to dominate and exclude one another, when the temptation to seek domination and exclusion may be riding high in our own hearts. Well, I tried. There's just nothing to do. There's nothing left. The temptation is to sink to the lowest in the name of the highest. And we gather this morning, this Memorial Day, in the memory of those who lived and served and died in our name, whether or not we asked them to. And I include in that number not only those who have put on a uniform, but also all those who lived their lives in the service of the cause of a more perfect union, like Wade Till, like Alandria Williams. So on this morning, with the memory of those beloved, those fallen, I remember the charge of President Lincoln on the Gettysburg battlefield, that the nation somehow, through our feeble efforts, might have a new birth of freedom, and that government of the people, by the people, and for the people shall not perish from this earth. As we take up that task, that noble task in our lifetimes, in this season of fear and anxiety and mistrust, we might be tempted to resort to means of control, to making the circle smaller and tighter. But instead, let us hear that invitation to surrender ourselves to the wild, flowing, creative power of love. Let us be as tenacious as red ants, as full of joy as a pickup soccer game, and let us see hope in every other person we meet.
Please rise in body and spirit as we sing our closing hymn, hymn number 345 in the gray hymnal, "With Joy We Claim the Growing Light." Hymn number 345.
Thank you.
And now is your last act of worship. Turn and greet your neighbor.
Hey, good to see you.
Nice to see you.